speak here. And I am very happy to speak here. Why? I gave a number of talks on similar subjects, different time series for conferences. But each time I had to ask an excuse. Sorry, there will be no new series in my talk. Only computer revelations and some guesses. And so when I got an invitation to this meeting, I decided immediately I should go. It's a proper place to speak about conjectures, experiments, and nobody would demand from me immediate series. But on the other hand, I am in a difficult position. It was said many times here that we have experts from different areas: mathematics, computer science, chemistry, philosophy. And so I need first to make a short introduction into this area before I can explain what I was doing myself. So I will start from Euler, great mathematician who spent half of his lifetime in St. Petersburg, where I was born and live now. He considered such a series. It's an example of what is called Dirichlet series. It's similar to Taylor series, but the exponent is now, the value is now in the exponent, and integers are the basis. And Euler gave another definition of this sum in the form of this product. And the proof is very simple. One needs just to know that this expression is nothing else but the sum of this geometrical progression. What would happen if we remove the traces here? We would obtain all possible products of all possible powers of prime numbers. And so actually, Euler identity is just another form of the fundamental theorem of arithmetic stating that each natural number is represented in an essentially unique way as a product of prime numbers. This is a very simple fact, but it explains why this function plays so great role in the study of prime numbers. Because it connects two objects. Here we have the products over primes only, and here we have, so to say, homogeneous sum over all natural numbers. And Euler immediately used this identity to give a new proof of the fact that there are infinitely many prime numbers. Of course, you remember the famous proof given by Euclid. And Euler gave a new proof, and I believe that his proof is as elegant as original Euclid's proof. Euler's proof can be stated just in one phrase. If the number of primes would be finite, then the divergent harmonic series would have finite sum equal to this product. And so, this sum, traditionally denoted by Greek letter zeta of s, is named Riemann's zeta function. Why Riemann's, but not Euler's? What new was done by Riemann? Namely, he began to study this function for complex argument. Euler considered only the case when the argument was a real number. And this series converges in the semiplane where the real part of S is greater than 1. But it can be analytically extended to the whole complex plane, except the pole S equal to 1, where the harmonic series diverges, and this is the only pole of zeta function. And already Euler indicated that negative even integers are zeros of this function. And now these numbers are called the trivial zeros of the zeta function. But Riemann began to study complex zeros of this function, and he found a very interesting formula connected with this famous function pi of x, which gives us the number of primes below or equal to x. Already Gauss found that this pi of x is well approximated by this integral. And we could say that Gauss was doing experimental mathematics. He had no proof. He just studied tables of primes and made a guess. And this integral grows approximately as x divided by log of x. And Riemann gave this formula, pi of x is indeed, this is, so to say, the main term, plus another term, which is, roughly speaking, square root of this term, plus this sum taken over all zeros of this function. But nowadays, it is more traditional and more convenient to work not with function pi, but this function psi introduced by Russian mathematician Tibyshov. This function can be defined by such summation. We sum over all q that are less or equal to x, but we allow q to be either a prime or a power prime. And each time we add the log of this prime p. This could look rather artificial definition. But here is, okay, first we can compare it with the function pi of x. It is a similar function, but we sum ones instead of logs of p, and we sum only of prime numbers, not over powers of prime numbers. And psi of x has another quite nice definition. It's just logarithm of least common multiple of integers below or equal to x. So, it is easy to see that log of x grows rather slowly, so we should expect that psi of x should be approximately equal to pi of x multiplied by log of x. We know that this is approximately x divided by log of x, so we should expect that psi of x should be approximately equal to x. Here is just a plot of this function psi of x. You see it has jumps at prime numbers 2, at prime number 3, at power of prime number 2, jump at prime 5, no jump at composite 6, and jump at 5, at 7, and so on. And Riemann gave this formula, and much later, von Mandel gave a counterpart in terms of the function psi of x. They look very similar. Here we have again summation over all the rows. But now the main term is very simple compared to this integral, and the summons are also much simpler. I would like to show how these sums look when we bound the range of zeros, when we sum only over zeros which are less than 50 in absolute value. It looks like this. So it's not just a step function, it's continuous, of course, but summation approximating this step function. If we take greater bounds, we will get a better approximation. Here, even better approximation. I like to give this theorem in my talks, but I would like usually to give another point of view on it. Von Mandel theorem is an identity, and how we usually understand an identity. We have left-hand side, right-hand side, a free parameter. We can substitute any value, calculate, and obtain the same values. But let us do something different. Imagine that we do not know prime numbers at all, even the definitions. But we have calculate, computer, we can calculate zeros of theta function and can start making such summations and draw corresponding pictures. We would notice that this became look like a step function, and the steps take place at some integers. And we can guess that these numbers could be something interesting. And actually they are just prime numbers and powers of prime numbers. So I could say that we could discover prime numbers from the rows of the zeta function. And even we can do it in two ways. Instead of places where we have jumps, we can look at the sizes of jumps. And the sizes of jumps are always logarithms of prime numbers. So we can say that the rows of zeta functions encode in this particular way prime numbers. And now I can say very briefly what I will be speaking about. I will show you yet another way how prime numbers could be discovered from the rows of zeta function, how the zeros encode prime numbers. What was of interest for number series is how well this x approximates this function psi of x. And the answer depends on the real path of these zeros. And the famous Riemann hypothesis states that this real path should be equal to 1/2. Riemann himself was able to prove only a weak effect that all zeros lie in this so-called critical strip with real path between 0 and 1, non-strictly between 0 and 1. But he predicted that they should in fact lie on this critical line. The Riemann hypothesis implies that psi of x approximates x to the order of square of root of x, or equivalently, pi of x is this logarithm bit, this big gross estimate of the error. These are all equivalent formulations, but can be derived from another. The Riemann hypothesis is very important number theory. There is a lot of results proved only conditionally. And it also has applications in computer science. For example, the fastest primality test known today is based on extended Riemann hypothesis. Now I can start explaining what I was trying to do. We have this zeta function defined by infinite series, but we could try to look at something finite, finite sum. It's not useful to just cut the sum up to some capital N, because inside the critical strip, which is observed for us, the series doesn't converge. So my idea was to look for other finite Dirichlet series with some numbers lowercase delta is two subscripts capital N and lowercase n. The question was how to select these lowercase deltas. What would you be like from this finite sum? You would like it to be in some sense similar to this infinite sum. In what sense? Of course, you would like it to have similar zeros. And so let us take it as the definition of these deltas. Let us define these numbers by the following conditions. Let us demand that this finite sum should have n minus 1 common zeros with this infinite sum. Why n minus 1? Because we can always multiply by any number. So we have here a freedom, and we can add conditions that the first coefficient should be equal to 1. Then we have n minus 1, three parameters. We can hope to find such a finite series. So what I did was the reverse of the order of things. Usually we start from some function or equation and ask what are the roots. And here I demanded, I want these zeros, what will be this function? More formally, I can define this quantity in the following way. We have zeta function. It has zero. And it is known that if it has a zero, then its conjugate is also a zero, because here we have real coefficients. If we believe in the Riemann hypothesis, we can write that this zero is one half plus something imaginary. And if you believe that all zeros are simple, you can order them by the size of this imaginary part. So we want to deal with such finite sums. We will take for n always an odd number, so n plus 1. And we define this function by the condition that it should vanish at the 2m pairs of conjugate zeros. How could we find these numbers? We can give more explicit definition. Let us consider such determinant. Here, the rows correspond to natural numbers from 1 to capital N, and columns correspond to zeros of the zeta function and the F and conjugates, except of the last column, where we have the free variable X, free variable S. If this S is equal to one of these zeros, then there will be two equal columns, and the determinant would vanish. But syntactically, we can expand the determinant according to the last column, and it will be what we needed, a finite Dirichlet series. It is not exactly what we needed, because we wanted the cross coefficient to be equal to 1. So what we need to do is just to make normalization. We will divide by the cross coefficient, and so we define these coefficients in this way as such ratios. We can go further and give quite the definition of these numbers. I mean, just to cross out the last column and to cross the lowercase n row, defining these numbers. Then we make normalization and consider such sums. And we can try to consider properties of this capital delta as a function of S, and properties of lowercase deltas by themselves. And both turned out to be rather interesting. So I was just curious to see what would happen. I had a computer at my disposal, and it was quite easy to make original interpretations. Let us consider the case when capital N is 8, N is equal to 17, and here is the plot of these deltas. What do we see? We see that originally the coefficients are close to 1, but then they gradually decay. So visualization helps us to say something. But still, we are doing mathematics, and we would need to write in some symbolic way. And I introduced the following notation. This notation is double harpoon. It is a relation of similarity between two Dirichlet series. And this is a very, very weak relation. Says that several initial coefficients of the both series are approximately equal. So the weakness is due to two reasons. First, we demand only approximate equality and only of a few initial coefficients. But you will see that nevertheless, such a weak similarity sometimes suggests very interesting formulas. And here is the plot of zeta function on the critical line and our delta in the case 17. What we see? We see that, of course, the function vanishes at the 8 zeros used for its contraction. That between we have a very good coincidence of the values. Something is not so good at the beginning, and not good at the end, but here it's rather good estimation. But what is more interesting, that approximation is rather good at some distance after this 8-0. And in particular, this finite sum vanishes near the zeta zeros not used for its construction. And here is just a table. It vanishes at a distance of less than 10 minus 3 to the next zero, the ninth zero. It has two common decimal digits with the 10th zero and so on. Okay, it was interesting, and I continued calculations. Here is the case M50, and we have much better approximations. The function has 17 common digits with actual zero of zeta function not used in this construction. Here we have 14 common digits and so on. And if we go even further, we'll get much more better approximations. So we have more than 1,000 common digits, and even if we go far enough, we still have more than 100 common digits of our finite sum and the genuine zeta function. So I would say informally that zeta zeros are very knowledgeable. Initial non-trivial zeta zeros somehow know about a certain amount of subsequent non-trivial zeros. Is it surprising or not? Okay, we'll discuss it a bit later. You remember that besides non-trivial zeros, zeta function has trivial zeros, minus 2, minus 2, and so on. And surprisingly, this capital delta vanishes near minus 2, minus 4, minus 6, and so on. We did not use trivial zeros in the construction at all. So I can say that the zeros are very, very knowledgeable. They know about consequent non-trivial zeros, and they know about initial trivial zeros as well. So is it surprising or not? Let us consider more familiar situation with Taylor series. Suppose we want to approximate it by polynomials having common zeros with this function. And if our function is a good one, expand it into the product, and we just need to take initial factors. Does this function know anything about next zeros? Nothing. It cannot know because the following zeros could be arbitrary. And so it's rather surprising that zeros of zeta function somehow know about other zeros. And I believe that this is because the property to be defined by Dirichlet series is a rather strong restriction on a function. So this is the picture that you saw already. But now I will show you a picture when capital N is equal 101. And the picture is quite different. When I saw it for the first time, I believed I had a mistake in my program. Why such a big difference? And so this is a lesson that what we saw for small values of parameters need not be true for all of them. And in fact, this picture is more typical than the initial pictures which you saw for 17. So what should we say now about similarity? Now we should say that this delta looks like alternating sum, which is just the product of zeta of s to this factor, which is known as zeta function. And so it was rather natural to conjecture that if we fix lowercase n and allow capital N to go to infinity, then these deltas will be alternatively plus and minus ones. In other words, we started with the problem approximating zeta function by finding different series having the same zeros, but obtain the approximation to such a product. Why? In fact, this product naturally has the same zeros as zeta function, as seen here. But it has also additional zeros from this vector. So we cannot distinguish zeta function and theta function by looking just as complete zero. So if we return again to the analogy with Taylor series, we have our numerical function and we try to consider the polynomial constructed from initial zeros, this will not approach these coefficients. It will approach only coefficients from the numerator of this fraction. So it's quite natural that we obtain either function and not the zeta function. And it suggests that we should treat zeta function as such a ratio. Zeta function is an entire function and defined for when real part of s is equal to greater than zero. But the question is why this particular denominator, but I will not dwell on discussing this interesting fact. So, zeta function has this extra factor which has extra zeros. They are of such a form. And in fact, our delta function benefits close to these zeros of this extra factor. So I will continue saying that, the zeros are very, very knowledgeable. We know about subsequent non-trivial zeros, initial trivial zeros, and somehow they know about the power of zero because they cancel this factor, because they produce the zeros of this factor canceling the power. Now let us return to the second part by looking at the properties of these numbers by themselves. And suddenly they should be very interesting numbers because they produce such a good approximations to zeros. And I believe in some sense they are more interesting than the zeta zeros themselves. So this was a conjecture which I mentioned already. But when I continued to calculate, I found such a situation. Yes, indeed, we start with alternating plus and minus ones. But then, before vanishing, somehow they jump an absolute value. Why? I have no idea. Whether it's due to this particular number 221, or because it's due to the 110 theta zero. There are even more striking examples. Here, before vanishing, they somehow change the signs and jump rather high. I wish to show you many such pictures. So the pictures is always more or less the same, but every now and then there are some exceptions. I don't know why, and my hope is that gradually they would not appear any longer. So let's return to visualization. Here is a typical picture, the first ones and minus ones, but we cannot see much here. It looks like a straight line. But you can guess that these numbers are not equal. So So let us do the following. Let us subtract one. We will consider only deltas which are near zero, near one. This will be some small quantity. So we take absolute value, take logarithm, and I will show you the picture how these numbers look like. This picture is familiar to you, no, is not? Have you ever seen anything like this? Okay, let us try to understand what do we see here. So again, I have here some visual observations. We see that points are split into several levels, horizontal levels. They are approximately equal. What are these points? They correspond to even numbers of lowercase n. When delta is close to minus 1, and this is close to minus 2, and so this is just log of 2. Here numbers go with step 6. They correspond to n divisible by 3, but not divisible by 2. On the next level, we have numbers divisible by 5, but not divisible neither by 2 nor by 3. On the next level, we have divisibility by 7, but neither by 2, nor by 3, nor by 5. Divisibility by 11, 13, 17. And what are the remaining numbers here?
Primes.
So how would you call this picture?
Sieve.
It's a sieve of a sinus. The distribution on levels corresponds to the steps in his algorithm. So Edasinus was a human being. He invented a method. And here we used a stupid computer, first to calculate zeros, then to calculate the dominance, and then to make such a plot. And in a miracle way, we discover prime numbers. Okay, so here I took a large value for capital N 3000, but plotted lowercase n only up to 300. And of course, we cannot be happy forever. The total picture looks like this. We see that these levels suddenly stop when they touch some mysterious curve. The form of this cone was a great mystery for me. And finally I came to empirically to the guess that if we make a scaling, if we divide here lowercase n by n, and here divide our logarithm again by n, then the pictures would approach some limiting picture, and this curve might look like this strange expression. Again, it was just theoretical, and I have no proof at all. Let us again look at this picture. We saw all these points lying on a straight line, but again, you can guess that these points do not lie exactly on the same levels. And we can have a closer look at this line. So we will consider every third delta. And I will subtract not one by the first division by three. And here is the picture. It looks similar, but a bit different. Again, here we have even numbers. But here we have numbers divisible by 5, but not divisible by 2. And here, numbers divisible by 7, but not divisible neither by 2 nor by 5. And only on the next level, we encounter a number divisible by 3, but not divisible neither by 2 nor by 5 nor by 7. And the rest continues as before, 11, 13, so on. So we can say that again we have a sieve of a descendant, but now the order of primes is different. 5, 2, 5, 7, 3, 11, 13. Is this order natural or not? Let's recollect that here we have considered the index 3m. So the divisibility of m by 3 means the divisibility of this index by 9. So it's placed in the correct place between 7 and 11. So again, this anode, all little quantities, we can consider a finite structure. Then seems that this fractal structure goes forever. And here is just my guess how it should look like. If we allow n to range over an arithmetical progression d to d and so on, where d has such expansion with the product of prime powers, then corresponding sublevel in the sinus sieve will split according to the divisibility of m by numbers p1, p2, and so on, where they are ordered in such a way that such powers go in this way. In the previous example, m was equal to 3. This coefficient was 0 except for this one equal to 1. So p1 was 2, p2 was 5, p3 was 7, and so on. And we just had seen this ordering of primes. So there is somehow a very interesting, but not much understood, fractal structure. I would like to show you now another kind of sieve. Let us plot such quantities. We just sum our data up to some limit. The plot looks a bit different. Here you have lower case n, not divisible by 2. Here, on the next level, divisible by 2, but not divisible by 3. Here, divisible by 3, but divisible by 6, but not divisible by 12. Here, divisible by 12, but not divisible by 16. Here, divisible by 60, and we continue, we see that as soon as you have divisibility by divisibility by 7 disappears, the point drops below, and when divisibility by 8 appears, it drops yet below. So in order to describe this sieve more formally, yes, and this is a whole picture for greater values. We can introduce the notion of inheritance divisor. K is inheritance divisor of M if it divides M and all previous natural numbers also divide M. And of course we can find the maximal inheritance divisor. It's inheritance divisor, but the next number already is not divisor of M. The formal description of these levels is as follows. The numbers are distributed according to their maximum inheritance divisor. On the first level, odd numbers and numbers divisible by 2, but not by 3, and so on. Why do I call this dual sieve? Let us consider such presentation of the sieve of Cartesianus. We have natural numbers, we have many levels, here we have every second number, every third, every fourth, and every sixth, and so on. we remove the red tape, and that was this. A place according to their least prime divisor. And this corresponds to, looking at the logarithms of these differences. Now we can do the following. We can consider that complement the green part, remove the blue part, and then remove the red tape, and now our numbers will distribute according to that number of divisor. So in this sense, this sieve is dual to the Erasmus sieve. But it's produced from the same data, but taken in a different way. Besides the function, there are many other functions which are supposed to satisfy the counterpart of the Riemann hypothesis. And these functions are expected to have some other common properties with the function. And one of these properties is so-called functional equation. I will explain what it is later. It is expected that if the function doesn't have functional equation, it wouldn't satisfy the counterpart of the Riemann hypothesis. But so far, we haven't used the functional equation at all. What is the functional equation? We can multiply our zeta of s by this function. Here we have three factors. This factor cancels the pole of s, of zeta of s. The poles of gamma of s cancel the trivial zeros of zeta of s. This exponential factor doesn't influence neither poles nor zeros, but it allows to write this very nice quality, which is called the functional equation. How could we use it in our context? C function has the same imaginary complex zeros as zeta function. And we cannot tell in our construction not to use trivial zeros, just use particular zeros. And it was not clear how we can introduce the functional equation in this context. But nevertheless, this could be done. So let us do the following. We have the functional equation. We can write that zeta of s is this product. And we can just introduce this vector under the summation sign. But thanks to the functional equation, we can write another equality with s replied to by 1 minus s. And now we can just sum these two infinite summations. And I will denote this sum by f sub n of s. And clearly, this function f of n satisfies the counterpart of the functional equation. F of s is equal to f of 1 minus s, just because we used symmetrical expression. So it looks that we have got the functional equation for nothing. But there is here a bit of cheating, because this series converges only when the real part of S greater than 1. This series converges only when the real part of S is less than 0. So this is just a formal equality, which has no computational, direct computational sense. Nevertheless, we can do what we did before. We can consider such determinants, but now we can use here this function f. Again, columns correspond to zeros. We need no longer to consider conjugate zeros because our function, despite the functional equation, it will be automatically. We expand it according to the last column. we make normalization. We can consider such Dirichlet series. Please pay attention that here we have a genuine Dirichlet series with n minus the power minus s without this gamma factor, this g factor. I wish to work with the genuine Dirichlet series. And if you wanted normalization of this determinant, we will need to use these two sums. So this delta with superscript gamma need not vanish when s is one of the previous zero. But nevertheless, it vanishes very close to zero. And also it vanishes close to other zeros not used in this construction. So this is very similar to the previous case. This is the plot for previous case, and now the plot for deltas with the superscript gamma, it looks a bit different. But nevertheless, we still have a kind of shift of Hertzianus. This is the total picture. But now we can do something interesting. So our deltas look like alternating delta function. And we can just divide left hand side by zeta function. It's just a formal division of one finite Dirichlet series by an infinite Dirichlet series. It will be an infinite Dirichlet series with some coefficients mu. And according to this very big relationship, we could expect that this could be approximately 1 minus 2 multiplied by 2 minus s. That is, the first coefficient should be close to 1, the next close to minus 2, and the others should be very small. These numbers can be defined directly. And here, this mu is the membrane function. And we just need to extend the definition of deltas for m greater than capital N. And that is how these numbers mu look like. At first, they decrease very sharply, and then they split into two levels. And the total picture looks like this. Initially, we have this splitting, and then they again go to some strange curve. Let us have a look, closer look at this splitting. So I used two colors, magenta, for the case of positive mu, and green for negative mu. And we see that on this level, we have all values of the same sign. Here we have values of different signs, and the order of signs is quite chaotic, and I cannot give any idea what is this order. And what are these numbers here? As by miracle, they again primes and powers of primes. I wish now to do the following. Okay, so let us have a closer look at this line. In the other scale, it looks something like this. We see splitting on several levels. These numbers correspond to primes. This correspond to squares of primes, to cubes of primes, and so on. So it suggests that we should make normalization by dividing by this local fan. Then we have horizontal levels. We suggest that we should divide not by logarithm of n, but by magnitude function of n, which is defined in the following way. If n is the power of prime p, then it's log of p and zero otherwise. And if we divide by the magnitude function, we have all points lying on the same level. This number is very small, and approximation is rather good. Now I would like to adjust this picture. So here we have something very regular, but initially we have different picture. I wish to remove 11 initial points and to add initial 11 values on this level. Formally, I just make such addition. I remove original points and I add new points. And I should say that this looks like this infinite sum, with coefficients being the von Mandel function. And this sum is very well known. It's just the minus logarithmic derivative of the zeta function. But you remember that this is a very micro-legend shift. This initial coefficients look similar only on a very small initial frequency. After that, these coefficients here begin to grow very, very much. But coefficients here remain small because of this very small spectrum. And still the question, does this very weak relationship suggest that this quantity could be somehow equal to this logarithmic derivative? We can multiply it by zeta of s and ask whether this could be true or not. It's natural to start by looking at it when s is a zero of zeta function, then this additional sum would just disappear. Is it true that the value of our data look like this derivative? Indeed, they do look, and you can see that approximation is roughly good. It's not so good at the beginning, and it's not so good for greater values, but in between it is the best. And if you want to approximate zeta at other points, we need to use this additional finite sum. And we get very good approximation to the value of the derivative for positive values of s on the critical line. And to the left of the critical line, we still have very, very good approximation by such expressions. In order to use this expression, we need to know the value of zeta itself with great accuracy, because here there is a great cancellation. And we can avoid it in two ways. Either we can write such equalities for two different capital n's, n1 and n2, treat zeta of s and its derivative as unknowns and solve this system, and we would obtain the same calculation, a rather good approximation to zeta itself in a large range of values, and not so good approximation for its derivative. Or we could use the same capital N to write the functional equation, to write it symbolically differentiated, and treat it as a system of four linear equations with four unknowns, zeta, its derivative, zeta at point 5 minus s, and its derivative. And solving this system, we can obtain, I mean, this is the value of zeta of s, its derivative at point s and 1 minus s. So it's not clear why we get such a good approximation by such strange calculations. So I put my discoveries on this side. You are welcome to visit it every now and then and see if there is something new. But I would be happy if you would be involved in this study, and I would be happy to enter the site your discoveries. Thank you for your attention.